Today I am looking at 2 Kings chapter 5 verses 1 through 14. I'll just read verse 1 just so we get an idea of what we're dealing with here. It says, Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and in high favor because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper. Okay, so here we have a man, a powerful man, a man of status, a man of authority, a man of importance. He is leading an army, and the Lord's giving him victory even. So God used him despite of, you know, his lack of spirituality. He was fighting for Syria. So he's an important man, but he's got a problem here. We see he was sick. He was physically sick, and he couldn't get well by any worldly means. And he had many worldly means. All his pomp and pleasure and resources, they all failed him because he was physically sick. And as we find, as we read on, he was quite desperate to be well, as any of us would be in that position. So desperate, in fact, that he took the advice of a little no-name servant girl. If we look at verses 2 through 4, chapter 5, it says, Now the Syrians on one of their raids had carried off a little girl from the land of Israel, and she worked in the service of Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, Would that my lord were the prophet who is in Samaria, were with the prophet who is in Samaria. He would cure him of his leprosy. So Naaman went in and told his lord, Thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel. And the king of Syria said, Go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So the little no-name girl, who just happens to be Jewish and knows the Jewish God, the God of Abraham, our God, and knows the prophet, that there is a prophet even, says, this little girl, she says, do this. And this big, important, powerful authority listens. He listens to this little girl. Isn't that amazing? He's desperate. There could be no other explanation for this. He's altogether desperate. And here's hope. Here's hope in the God of Israel. There's a man, there's a prophet, he can heal you. Like, she just claims that for him. Like, she knows that the prophet can do it. She doesn't know that he will, but she's holding on to the promises of God, saying, I know this God, and I think that he can heal you. I know that he can. So here's your hope. So he doesn't send for the prophet, although he could have done that. He goes to him. He's respectfully going to the prophet, and he's not sure how to find him. So he takes money, he takes gifts, and he sends his servant with his money and gifts and a letter to the king of Israel. And he's asking to be cured of his disease. He's figuring if anyone knows how to find this guy, right, it's the king. So he sends a letter to the king of Israel and asks to be healed. So the king of Israel is not too happy about this. Naaman, being a foreigner, had no knowledge. He really had no knowledge, probably, of the things of God or how they worked. All he had was the hearsay of this little girl who says, there's a man here who can heal you, this little Jewish slave girl. So that's all he's going on. He's sending a letter to the person he thinks that can find this man that can heal him. And the king of Israel, though, is just upset. He understood that he couldn't heal Naaman. He didn't have any power in and of himself to do that. He's like, am I God? I can't do this. He tears his robes. He's like, this guy's just trying to start a fight with me. Because this very desperate and diseased man, who just so happened to look a whole lot like his enemy, because a lot of times there was fighting between Syria and Israel, and so here's this big bad guy of the world coming to him like, you're gonna do this for me, and he's like, I can't do this, I'm not God. Like, He's forgetting about the prophet. He's not thinking about the promises of God and how God may well want to use him to be an instrument to help this man. He's not thinking that way. He's thinking about one thing, and that's himself. His own protection. He's afraid. He's intimidated. You know, when your enemy or someone who looks like your enemy comes, it's real easy to get this attitude that the king of Israel had that paints them in a certain light that says, you know what, this is who they are, and I know that they're just doing this to hurt me or cause a problem with me, and why me? And that's essentially what he's doing when he tears his robes. There's nothing I can do about this, and why is he doing this, and why is God allowing this? This is where he is. He's self-preserving. He wants nothing to do with this request from this king, and he's fearing for his own well-being, probably for his country, and he's presuming evil upon someone who he just doesn't trust and who is huge to him, who is terrifying to him personally. This is what's going on in the heart of the king of Israel when he receives this request with this letter. And, you know, again, when a powerful man asks for something impossible, an impossible gift, sometimes the representatives of the giver of that gift get scared. So many a strong man they're seeking a cure. They're not physically sick, they're spiritually sick, and they're seeking a cure. But salvation is impossible for those men. It's impossible for all of us, and we know that. But when those big, bad, would-be enemies come knocking on our door asking for a cure, we needn't get scared. It is impossible for us to give them the cure, but we can send them to the person who does have it, which is Jesus Christ. So, again, the king of Israel forgets about his prophet, doesn't even think like this little slave girl. She was thinking more spiritually than this king was thinking, because she's like, I know a guy. I know a guy that can do this. I know that he can, because she trusts the promises of God, and she knows. So anyway, let's see. So after the king tears his robes, Elisha the prophet reminds him of the greatness of his God. If you look at verses 9, I guess, verses 8 through 12, it says, But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king, saying, why have you torn your clothes? Let him come now to me, that he may know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean. But Naaman was angry and went away, saying, behold, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call upon the name of his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. Okay, so what's happening here? Naaman comes. Elisha sends a messenger to tell him how to be cured. And Naaman lives happily ever after? No. What does Naaman do? Naaman gets mad. And why does he get mad? This is just what the king of Israel was afraid of. Great. Now this big, important, powerful authority warrior man is mad. He's enraged at me, probably at my country, at it all. So why is he mad, though? In verses 11 and 12, which we just read, they tell us it was his pride. He was personally insulted. He's like, you know, this guy didn't even come out to meet me. He didn't do what I was, it was failed expectations. Like, I thought he was going to come out and wave his hand and do the magic and I would be cured. But no, that's not what happened. he sent a messenger to tell him to do this very simple and almost silly thing, go wash in the river seven times, or, you know, and things just didn't go as Naaman had in his mind that he was expecting them to go. And he also felt that his country was insulted because, you know, they're saying go wash in the Jordan. Well, why can't I go wash over here in these cleaner, better rivers in my country? Like, so he is reasoning through this, and he's just prideful, and he's not wanting to do it the way that God has prescribed. He's wanting to do it his own way. He thinks that's how he's going to be healed, and that's how he's going to be cured. He's got all the good ideas, and you know, this is, you know, to give him, I guess, some credit. I mean, Naaman, this is the guy, first of all, he doesn't know God. Second of all, he is a man who is like a boss. Like, he's used to giving orders, and he's used to men taking them, and he's used to that working out pretty well for him because, you know, God had given him victories and things. So this is a guy that's used to things being done in a certain way, and he has these expectations, but, you know, he's being told to do things that he thinks are just silly. But as he will soon find out, the Lord doesn't work in ways that we approve of. He does things the way that he wants to, and we are the ones that need to obey. So he's enraged. He's extremely mad that things have gone this way. But fortunately for him, God is altogether determined to have mercy on this particular man for whatever his reason is. Elisha tells us, so that he may know that there's a prophet in Israel. So there's the reason. But God's going to have mercy on Naaman. So if we look at verses 13 and 14, what happens after he leaves in a rage? But his servants came near and said to him, "My father, it is a great word the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Has he actually said to you, wash and be clean?" So he went down and dipped himself seven times in the Jordan according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. So, okay, this is great. Like, this is so great. This is the story of all of us, right? Because we don't deserve it. You know, so many times we're coming to God like, we want this and we want that, and God's saying, okay, you know, do this, just obey. And we're like, no, we're not going to obey. We're not going to do that. Like, that's stupid. I'll just go do my own thing. Well, fortunately for Naaman, his servants come to him after he gets mad and decides he's just not going to do that thing that the prophet tells him. And they come to him respectfully. They come to him in love, and they say, "My father," this is how they address them, "My father, did you hear what the prophet said? Like, he didn't tell you to do some, you know, he didn't tell you to jump through 15 hoops and bend over backwards. Like, the prophet told you some good news. Like, did he really say wash and be clean? Like, prophets don't say that every day. Prophets don't just say whatever it is they feel like saying. Like, if God wasn't saying be clean, be healed, the prophet wouldn't have told you that. Like, this is good news. Why don't you just go do it?
Go try it.
What do you have to lose?" Like, and so they carefully and graciously, gently tell this big, important man, just try it.
Just do what the prophet said.
He gave you good news. He didn't condemn you. He didn't say God will not heal you. He said, go be clean. So Naaman listens. He listens to his servants. Even so, and there's a lesson even in that. Matthew Henry comments on it, which I would just like to read his words because they're just so good. I love Matthew Henry. So he says, "The modest advice which his servants gave to him, to observe the prophet's prescriptions with a tacit reproof for his resentments, though at other times they kept their distance." So these servants of his, they weren't guys that were just like always telling him what to do. They usually just let him make the decisions and just fell in line. But now they see that, you know, they love their master. They don't want to see him die of this disease. They want to see him cured. And so they graciously, tenderly, respectfully go to him and tell him this stuff. So usually they're at a distance, but now they saw him in a passion. He was mad. Yet knowing him to be a man that would hear reason at any time and from anybody, a good character of great men and a very rare one, they drew near and made bold to argue the matter with him a little. Okay, and it says, note, it is a great mercy to have those about us that will be free with us and faithfully tell us of our faults and follies, though they be our inferiors. Masters must be willing to hear reason from their servants. And we should have our ear open to good advice, though brought us by those who are much below us, no matter who speaks, if the thing be well said. So what Matthew Henry is saying is, no matter who's saying it, like if it's this little no-name, nobody servant girl, or if it's your servant, or if it's someone who you just, you know, maybe don't prefer, if it's not your boss, if it's not your spiritual elder, if it's not your pastor, if it's someone lower, someone who's just in your sphere of influence, who's saying the truth to you, you would do well to listen. Just like Naaman, you would do well to listen, because the truth is the truth is the truth. And sometimes those higher ups, they kind of, sometimes they give you wrong advice because they have their, they just have their alliances with you, and they have, you know, when you get too close to someone, sometimes you're afraid to tell them the truth, and there's just different things going on there. To where sometimes a little servant girl or one of your slaves even, or someone underneath you, when they come to you and tell you the truth, you'd do well to listen, because if it's the truth, it's going to be good for you. It's going to be good no matter what mouth it's coming from. We have to see that as coming from the Lord, and that's the Lord's provision. So praise God that he would send that mercy to us through whomever. So this is a great story. Like, I love this. It's just so encouraging to me. So God uses his friends, his servants, I guess, to help him see his foolish refusal to be healed. Like, that's what he was essentially doing. He wasn't refusing anything but being healed. So he thought that he was refusing orders from men he didn't trust, but he was really just refusing his own good. So a good thing to keep in mind as well. So in verse 15, this is great too. This is where it wraps up, and I just love it. It says, then he, Naaman, returned to the man of God, he and all his company, and he came and stood before him. And he said, behold, I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. So, accept now a present from your servant. And of course, Elisha wouldn't take the gift. And it goes on. But here's a man who's been converted. Like, he has seen the wonderful, wonder-working power of God in his life. And he's experienced it firsthand. And now he knows. He knows God. And that was the whole purpose in all of it from the very beginning. So God will have his way. He had his mercy on this man, like it or not. And now this man is coming and saying, I know that this is the only God. And what does that produce in him? It produces fruit that says, I want to give. I want to give something back to you, because what you have given me is such an amazing gift. So I guess moral of the story is, you know, just let's not let pride keep us from the amazing mercy of God. He wants to give mercy. He wants to give grace. He wants to be reconciled to us. He wants to cure us of our sickness and our disease and our sin. So we cannot allow pride in the enemy to keep us, and anger. I mean, Naaman had anger, from those things that God would have us to experience. Like, he wants good for us. So, amen. Thanks. See you next time.